Today's session is brought to you by BlessingWhite, a division of GP Strategies. BlessingWhite focuses on leadership development and employee engagement. I'm excited to introduce you to two members of their team and our presenters for today's session. Kristen Bakalar is a senior consultant who works every day with GP Strategies clients to build high-impact leadership development solutions. Kristen is a regular contributor to BlessingWhite's articles and research efforts. Fraser Marlow heads up BlessingWhite's leadership practice and leads many of the group's research efforts. Together, Kristen and Fraser co-authored the recently published research report on performance management. So we're delighted to have both of them here to present today. A copy of the research report itself will be emailed to you as part of the follow-up from today's session. So with that, Fraser, I'm going to turn the session over to you.
Well, thank you very much, Kayla, and welcome everybody. Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, depending on where you are in the world. I just wanted to thank everybody for playing ball here on this little slide. Great to get your feedback and your perspectives, and thank you for sticking to three words. That was great. You know, I think the quick takeaway from these little terms that we posted up here is this kind of mixed emotion around performance management. I think we all know that it's an important process, it's a critical process, and yet there's a lot of room for improvement. And I think you'll hear that theme come out quite strongly in our presentation today. So just to provide you with a quick agenda of what we'll be talking about, we are going to be talking about the definition of performance management. Why do we even have this process running inside our organizations? We'll talk a bit about the research that we have recently concluded and published in terms of how performance management is perceived and used inside organizations. We'll also be looking at some of the pioneering companies that have taken a new and fresh approach to make sure that performance management is in line with the organizations that they're trying to build, the cultures that they're trying to build. And we'll talk specifically about the emergence of coaching as a way of operating for managers in this new environment in which we are focusing much more on developing people rather than simply assessing them. And then we'll conclude with some guiding principles as we talked to organizations that have taken this journey. We find that there are a number of guiding principles that they applied in making sure that performance management works for them. And we'll wrap this up with just some notes on if you are interested in taking your organization down this road, what does it take? Right? What have these pioneering firms experienced? What are the big key phases and main areas you want to focus on? So with that as our quick agenda for today, we did invite some of you to give us some more elaborate input rather than just three words when you were registering for this session. And again, thank you very much for this. It really does help paint a more detailed picture of how everybody is perceiving performance management. And as you'll see from these quotes that we've pulled out here, this is just three of them. Again, kind of a mixed perception that this is really a process that needs to be run. It does tend to gravitate and become more of a tick-the-box exercise. It tends to elicit a lot of groans and moans from folks within the organization. And yet, I think we all appreciate that when it is done well, as expressed in the third quote here on this slide, if we are able to architecture or design the performance management process to be in line with what the business needs, we do see dramatic improvements in both performance, in productivity, but also in employee engagement and satisfaction across the organization. So as we start to explore this topic, let me take a little step back in history and ask ourselves, you know, why do we have performance management? At its heart, performance management is a pretty straightforward and pretty critical process. So we have cascaded organizational goals and strategies within the organization. They come down to a manager at the local level, and we would expect every manager to set performance expectations for people on the team for a given period. So that may be a year, but it may be 6 months. It may be the duration of a specific project. And then we deliver the work. We have that period of performance roll out. Hopefully there's some good feedback that's taking place during that so that people can stay on track. And at the end of the period of performance, we would sit down, review how well we did, and then as a group discuss any areas of improvement. We might do an appraisal of how well we did, celebrate success, and then talk about how do we help develop people so that we can perform at an even higher level. So certainly at its core definition, if we don't lose sight of this, of its core meaning and purpose, performance management is certainly something that we want to build. But what we've also seen over time is that around this particular process, a number of other things have been added on and scaled up. A lot of them around tracking skills inside the organization, mapping out development needs, thinking about things like succession planning. Who are we going to move up? What's the mobility of individuals based on past performance? So at its core, we have this very important strategic activity going on, but around that, it's grown and it's become padded out, and we've become very dependent on it to think in the bigger picture about talent and the performance of the organization. So this performance management process certainly isn't new. It's always been around. But what happened in the really in late 70s and the 80s, in that era of big monolithical corporations, those of you who were around at the time, you might recall that the corporate cultures were really quite different, and the pressures on organizations were quite different. And performance management, as it's become known, really was popularized. If one organization was really the name that is associated with it, it is General Electric and this man, Jack Welch. Yeah, I see from the quotes, I've got a few comments coming in here. You go, Neutron Jack. And that's exactly what Jack Welch was known as. And the term Neutron Jack came from his reputation for walking into entire departments or divisions of General Electric and shutting them down. And the reason that that was the kind of mantra at the time is that Jack Welch, along with many of his contemporaries in organizations, you know, like IBM and General Motors, were looking at large, fairly bloated and not very competitive organizations. And their entire process was to figure out who were the top performing employees so that they could get rid of those who weren't performing at a high level. So it was a pretty brutal era. It was one of, you know, high internal competition, but the ends may have justified the means in that it did get General Electric, it did get IBM, it did get GM to be much more competitive with particularly firms outside of their prime markets. But what we really have to remember is that, you know, we have moved on. So if you think about organizations today, they typically run lean. They are populated with very smart, very committed individuals. The culture inside organizations has very much moved away from those big bureaucratic, monolithical corporations that we used to know. And so as organizations run lean and run nimble, the performance management systems that we developed in the 80s are really an anachronism. And I think today that along with things like Tippex and the rotary phone and the 5-inch floppy disk, this old performance management approach using forms to stack people, rate people, with a view of eliminating the poor performers is completely out of sync with the cultures that we espouse to build inside organizations. Now, that's not true everywhere, of course, but for the vast majority of the organizations that we work with, they certainly have appreciated that their performance management process is completely out of sync with everything else they're trying to do around culture, around development, around innovation. And that's really what is prompting them to take a hard look at the way that they're approaching this. So just to reiterate this, if you think about your organization, you may place it somewhere on this continuum that you have in front of you. And with most of these continuums, nobody is far off on the left-hand side, nobody's far off on the right-hand side, but we need to decide as the leaders, as the guardians of the culture, where do we want to position ourselves? Right? What is the most appropriate approach to performance management today in our organization? Is it over here on the left-hand side, where we need that GE approach, we need to do triage, we need to get rid of some dead wood in the organization? That may be the situation you're in. Or do you want to lean more over onto the right-hand side, create a culture of collaboration, because you know you're already running lean. Now you want to develop the important resources that you have, You're certainly not looking at getting rid of people. On the contrary, what you're trying to do is to get more contribution, more dedication from the very smart individuals that are already on the team. And why this is fundamental, this continuum, is that depending on the philosophy that you adopt, you are going to cast the managers in your organization into essentially one of two roles. On the competitive side, you cast the manager as the boss, right, as the judge and jury of people's performance. This is the manager who is going to be more authoritative, more about giving orders and making sure that everybody can deliver. And now on the right-hand side, we're seeing the cultures move significantly more to the manager as coach. And that really requires both a different skill set for the managers. You don't have to just be a good functional manager. You have to be a great manager of people and a good leader of people. And what that also entails is actually a shift in mindset for many managers, to think about their team differently, to think about their own role differently. And that is really what emerged from the research that we recently published, is this cultural change happening inside organizations and how performance management as a process is causing a serious drag on making that transition from managers as boss over to managers as coach. So with that said, I'm going to hand over to Kristen, who's going to walk us through some of the data from the research.
Thank you, Fraser. So I'm going to go through a couple of slides that highlight some of the most the data and the research that stood out to us, and then we're going to kind of move on to sort of what do we do with that research. So we found that perceptions of performance management are a bit of a moving target, and that's because over half of the people, as you can see on the screen, who answered our survey have experienced some sort of change in their performance management in the last couple of years. Our sense is that organizations, as Fraser sort of pointed out, are consistently looking for better, improved, or in air quotes, the right way to go about performance management. And oftentimes those changes are to the process itself and not necessarily around the essence or the purpose of actually managing performance. And that can certainly impact employees' perceptions and we believe their level of trust. On the screen, actually, you'll see a quote that we took from someone who's here on the call with us today about the tweaks made to his or her process. We're going to do a little poll here. We actually asked this question, when it comes time for your end of year review, how do you feel? So we'd love to ask the people on the phone. There's a poll up on the right side of your screen, and we'd love to compare the answers that you guys give to the answers that we found in our research.
Thanks, Kristen. We'll give it about 30 more seconds. People are coming in, answering in right now. It's a pretty mixed result, so we look forward to sharing this shortly. We'll go ahead and close out in about 20 seconds.
Perfect. Our research showed a bit of ambivalence toward that end of year review as well, so we may have a good match here.
We've got about 10 more seconds, so go ahead and close out those answers, and we'll share the results shortly.
So, as I said, our research showed a bit of ambivalence toward that end of year review. As you can see on the screen, while roughly there were give or take 37% of respondents who had a somewhat positive perception, either being excited or looking forward to the experience, there were also that other 60% of people whose emotions ranged from being nervous to dreading it to not caring or feeling it was a waste of time or, for some, just some task simply to be performed. And as I'm looking at the poll, it almost matches, not necessarily number by number, but certainly you can see the correlation there between the people on the phone and our research. And I think you'll again hear that thread of ambivalence kind of called out throughout this entire presentation. On the screen, you'll see another poignant quote from someone on the line today who shared a story about his or her employees' reactions to their review. Admittedly, we got a little bit of a chuckle out of that one. We did some research on the manager's perceptions. So here we're looking at the manager's perceptions of the usefulness of performance management, as well as the ability to improve the performance of the manager's team members. So again, as you can tell, some managers seem to find their performance management system somewhat useful at 62%, and found that it helped them manage the performance of their team members at 59%. One of the interesting trends in the data that we saw was that when performance ratings, so the actual ratings, ranking 1 through 5 or 1 through 7, actually inhibited the manager's perception of the system actually, you know, being able to help them manage the performance of their team members. So what I'm trying to say is that that top number of 59% actually jumps to 65% when the organizations do not use a ratings approach. So we found that particularly interesting as we kind of think about manager as boss, who is rating, and manager as coach, who is developing, those numbers kind of shown through in the data. So I'm going to hand it back to Fraser, who's going to talk about some of the pioneering firms who are making some changes and leading the way in performance management.
Thanks. So there are many organizations out there who took a hard look at performance management inside their organization. As Kristen just shared with us, in the data, while there's a lot of moaning and groaning that goes on around the laborious paper-based process or forms-based process, sometimes that pain point doesn't get high enough in the barrier to really elicit the change. And then when you step back and think about changing the entire performance management process, that's quite a serious undertaking. It would take a lot of dedicated will and effort to make that change. But there are some organizations that decided to take the jump. So I'll share with you some of the ones that that we can list, because these, and I want to thank these organizations, not only did they take the lead in doing the change, but they have been very open to sharing with us and sharing with other media outlets what it took to go through this journey. And they've actually detailed, you can find this in many case studies, they've actually walked through all of the steps and all the pitfalls that they discovered along the way. So I think we should all be very grateful. While there's a dozen or so logos here on the site that you could look up and find their stories, there are many, many more organizations today who are either well underway in completely rethinking how they do performance management, or are certainly in the process today of doing away with their forms-based approach. And when we interviewed many of these organizations and talked to them, we asked them the question, well, what really were you hoping to get out of this change? Right? Why are you making this big effort to overhaul this process? And it really falls into two key buckets. The first is they saw great opportunity to improve pure productivity. And what I mean by that is they looked at the process with the forms and the amount of time that managers were spending on something which wasn't really yielding great results for them. And they decided, you know, if we just did away with all of this ranking and documenting people's performance, it would save us a whole boatload of time and we wouldn't really lose anything. So that's the key point behind reducing bureaucracy. But the other thing that these organizations noticed is that when they asked managers about how productive these conversations were, somewhat in the details that we just shared with you, they found that the conversations themselves weren't helping people become more productive. So they really wanted to rethink how can we get a manager and the manager's direct reports to have interactions in which we do literally see the productivity of that individual increase as a result. And then the final topic around productivity really tied back to the idea that if you do performance management on an annual cycle, well, there is no organization out there today that behaves on an annual cycle. I mean, we behave maybe on a 3-month cycle, a 6-month cycle. Projects are much shorter. Teams change so much faster. If you are having a manager do performance reviews for people on their team, good chance that the team itself has changed. So it's not a great process if you're doing things over a long, long period of time. But equally as important to these items around productivity, organizations talked about the need to drive engagement. So here what we're finding is that the topics revolve much more around driving individual satisfaction or individual trust with the organization and having interactions which were not going counter to the culture that we were really trying to build. Even when we looked at issues like turnover and innovation, we found that these also tied back to the performance management process, that people just feel that they're tired of being put through the grinder once a year. And finally, a topic that we will really come back to is that the performance management process, as it is administered in its old school format, has quite negative impact on trust, which I mentioned at the beginning of this list, but also on things such as perception of fairness and how other processes run inside the organization. And we'll come back to that. So Kristen, do you want to maybe walk us through some ideas on this transformation when it comes to coaching?
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you, Fraser. So at BlessingWhite, we have a model that we use to help us think about employee engagement and creating high-performing organization, which really incorporates two strategies. On one hand, we have the organization that has a strategy and a plan to drive towards success, whatever that may be, revenue, values, ethics, et cetera. And that success and what that vision of success is fairly well-defined. Presumably, your organization wants a culture of high performance. And so what we're looking at for the organization, how we can drive that high performance, is through maximizing contribution of all employees. The second strategy is a little bit more unique to the individual, which makes it a bit more complex. Each individual, all of us on the phone here today, have our own idea of what success looks like and what we want from our jobs. We all have unique values. We all have unique goals and motivations. But in the end, what we all want is maximum satisfaction from doing the work that we do in the environment we're in. Now, notice I did not say maximum satisfaction from my company. We're not talking necessarily about perks and bonuses or, you know, free food Fridays, but more so about having purpose, feeling as though what I'm doing every day has an impact and that it matters, and that my values are aligned, that I am having opportunities for personal development and growth, et cetera. These two strategies intersect daily on the job in a very dynamic way. This is essentially where the path of the organization intersects with the path of the individual. And building a high-performing culture really means maximizing both the contribution and the satisfaction of employees. So that becomes your culture. So as you can imagine, there are people all over the map. There are some people in your organizations that are very happy not contributing. There are people that are very unhappily but contributing a lot, and there are people that are in the middle. And the idea is to move them up to what we call the apex. And the way that we view that happening is through a coaching partnership. By me as the boss or me as the manager, as coach, understanding what my individual contributors and my employees need, how they view success, I'm thinking about how I can maximize their satisfaction. At the same time, I'm thinking about ways that we can maximize their contribution. Again, we call that the apex, and the way that we see that happening is through a coaching partnership. So I'm going to hand it over, and the idea of being at the apex, as we see it, is having more great days at work. The more great days at work you have, the more you're contributing and the more satisfied you are. I'm going to hand it back over to Fraser here to talk about some of the guiding principles that we found in performance management.
Fantastic. So that X model for us is very much a framework upon which we hang many of the conversations we have, both about performance but primarily around engagement. And so if you're asking managers now not only to think about that right-hand side, the blue side of that that X model, which really is what performance management typically focuses on, right? It's just simply let's score everybody on low performance to high performance. We're now asking managers to consider this second axis of, well, at the same time, how satisfied are the people on my team? Right? Are they getting what they want out of this relationship with the organization? So when we interviewed all of the organizations that have either made this transition or are in the process, what we found is that there isn't just one single approach to equipping the organization to make this change, from freeing ourselves from the forms and the process of old-school performance management and focusing on developing people and coaching people to higher levels of performance. That said, we did identify five key themes which came back. We're going to call them guiding principles. And if you take your organization down this road and think about jettisoning your old performance management approach, we would really encourage you to, you know, make four big sheets on the wall, write a guiding principle at the top of each one, and think through how each one of these applies to you and your specific context. So the first one that we are going to talk about is the conversation. If we are to make that X model come to life, the rubber meets the road where a manager is sitting down with one or more people on their team and discussing these dynamics. How do we help you improve your performance and your contribution to the success of the company? How do we also make sure that in the process of doing that, we are increasing your own personal satisfaction at work? And again, another great quote here that from somebody on the call today, just illustrating how that two-way dialogue really is the key to success versus this recap that happens once a year. So in the survey, we asked people to describe their feelings towards the organization on several fronts, and we also asked them, do you have regular conversations with your manager? And one of the things that really jumped out at us when we studied it is how these two correlate so closely. So what you can see here in the middle column, if people do not have regular conversations with their managers, then their performance of things like are performance assessments done fairly, right? Does does performance management give me good insights for improving my performance? Do I look forward to the end of year review, or do salary decisions seem arbitrary inside the organization? And as you can see on the right-hand column, if there are regular conversations happening with the manager, all of those scores increase quite dramatically. And if the last one looks bad, that's actually a good thing. The bottom one, we're glad to see that a lot less people think that salary decisions are arbitrary within the organization. So these are actually pretty powerful correlations when we analyze the dynamics within organizations. So if we can just encourage managers to have more regular conversations, and here's kind of the crux of the issue, we've been trying to do that for a long, long time. In fact, old school performance management dictates that managers will sit down with everybody on their team and, in theory, will give them a debrief of how well they've done typically for the last 12 months. So we have to look back at that same topic of that conversation between the manager and the employee, but think about it in a very, very different context. So how much structure should we really be introducing to this conversation? And this is really an interesting point when you think through, if you're in organizational development, if you're in HR, how many of these conversations should we be enforcing? And like Kristen, I'm using air quotes here, enforcing. And how much structure and guidance should we provide to the managers? And what we find is that the continuum upon which you want to think this is how much trust exists today between the manager and the people on the team? And how strong are the manager's skills when it comes to having these conversations and coaching? And as we've tried to illustrate for you here, as we go from low levels of trust or skill all the way up to high levels of trust or skill, we are going to move from high structure, which is what the plus on the right indicates, to low structure. So what that might look like is if you're dealing with maybe some trust issues on the team, maybe some shortages of skills, then it would benefit you to provide more structure around this. So maybe you say to the managers, you need to have a quarterly meeting. Here's a conversation guide. Here are specific topics that we want you to cover. So you're providing a fair amount of structure at that stage. As time goes by and trust is built within the team, or if trust exists already, maybe you'll just say, look, there's a number of conversations you need to have during the year. We'll give you some broad idea on the topics, but it's really up to you, the manager and the employee, to find the right time, find the right balance of how much time you spend on these things to make sure that these conversations are productive for you. And we've actually worked with some organizations who, in their employee engagement surveys and in their conversations with managers and their focus groups, they actually found that they already were operating at very high levels of trust. and that the managers were pretty skilled, the relationships were good, and therefore they jumped straight into very low levels of structure. They said, look, we're going to step out of this. We're not going to enforce it. It is up to you, the manager and the employee. We're going to set expectations more around what should an individual contributor at our organization expect from his or her manager. But beyond that, if you want tools, come ask us. We will provide you with the tools. If you're hungry for structure, we will give you that. But we're really going to step out of this and expect you to be having multiple touch points, short, long conversations, whatever works for you. But they found that that was a way of really freeing people up from the oversight that the organization felt before that they had to provide. And again, we do see a lot of these quotes that when people do throw out their formal performance review, pretty immediately the responses are very positive. There's some pushback, there's some hesitation, but for the most part, we see that people really do embrace this change pretty quickly. So again, thank you for whoever provided us with that quote for today. Guiding principle number two, if you are going to make this change, it is going to require some new skills. As I mentioned, both skills and also a slightly different mindset. When organizations did tackle this, they found immediately, they identified pretty quickly that managers needed better coaching skills. They needed some support around that. They maybe needed some help and training around emotional intelligence if these types of conversations were not things that they were frequently having. And the other thing that organizations really recognize gets lost in performance management is that very little of the contribution or the outputs that add up to the success of the company come from individuals. In reality, most of the work that we do is in teams. But the old school performance management approach, of course, scores people individually, right? We literally lock people into a room with their manager for half an hour or an hour to have this one-on-one conversation, which really often misses out the aspects of team dynamics. So that's something else that you might want to look at weaving in. But beyond just pure skills, there's also this change of mindset that managers have to appreciate that this time that they're going to invest in people is going to pay off, and that the people on their team have more to contribute than they are today, and that's what we'd refer to as a growth mindset. I'll talk about that a bit more later. But very quickly, and by quickly I mean probably within a year and a half, as they are evolving in this process, organizations realize that this new context means not just new skills for managers, but also resetting the context for individuals and providing some new skills there. So if you are going to free people up, if you're no longer going to rely on this framework, there are many parts of the organization where individuals need to know what the new rules of the road are. So there we've seen organizations equip individuals more around accountability, around taking charge not only of their own engagement, but their own career, really encouraging individuals to step up and become more active participants in the process, since we have educated people, you know, for better or for worse, with our old approach in being passive recipients of the data. So if we really want this process to work, it does help to move individuals from a passive recipient type role into an active role. And that brings us to guiding principle number three, which is, for this to work, we increasingly expect to put employees in the driving seat. So what do I mean by that? Well, let's just picture a manager who has, let's say, 7 direct reports. For the first 3 or 4 direct reports, they're going to invest quite a bit of time. There's going to be a lot of focus on making sure that these individuals get the feedback they need. But I can tell you from experience, having run teams of over 20 people, by the time you get over about 10 or 12 and you are going through the same types of conversation as a manager, it's really hard to find the time, find the commitment, find the energy to really give each person on your team the focus that they truly deserve. It really does become this exercise in trying to be original with each individual in the face of repetition. And again, to share a great quote which was shared with us from somebody on this call today, I'm going to guess somebody from my hometown of the United Kingdom. since they're talking here about bin lorries, so I actually gave you the American translation here. We in the States, we call them garbage trucks. But this is classic, right, that if you're doing 20 appraisals in one go, it's so tempting as a manager to just copy and paste. You've got 20 people doing the same job. You may not have had the great chance to know them each individually. And so it's a great tempting shortcut for a manager to do this. So what's the answer? Well, as long as you have a manager-driven process, you're really casting the manager back into that judge and jury role, as I mentioned at the beginning. You put the employees in a defensive stance because they feel like they're having to argue and hassle like they're buying a secondhand car to make sure that they get the best possible deal during this conversation. And you're really making yourself dependent on, well, what did that manager see and observe that individual doing in the last 12 months? But if you turn this conversation on its head and you say, you know what, we're going to let the employee drive the conversation. Now the employee feels much more empowered. They're able to share their own accomplishments. They can drive the conversation. They can take the conversation to places they want it to go. They're much more likely to be candid about saying, yep, I did very well on these things over the last 3 months, 6 months, but here's where I'm struggling. Here's where maybe I dropped the ball. And what we tend to find is that employees engaged in this type of a process, they tend to actually commit to more, to delivering more productivity than if the manager set the bar for them. And I think that's a very important takeaway in terms of our expectation of people in the workplace and how we really empower people to take control of their own, of their own future and their own contribution. And again, we had a great quote which came through in the as people were signing up for this session, and somebody shared this with us. And again, we were talking about one that made us chuckle. This one almost made me fall off my chair. It was so good. But, you know, in that old school approach, it is so tempting for the manager to just skim through and say, oh, look, somebody told me what they viewed as a personal development need. I'm going to post that in as a weakness because it ticks one of the boxes on the form. And that allows me to get to wrap this performance review up quickly. That was just fantastic. So thank you. I hope the person who shared that is on the call, and I just wanted to thank you for that. So if you put the employee in the driver's seat, what you'll find is the conversation is going to go to places which a manager would not typically go to. And these are three critical conversations, if you ask us at BlessingWhite, in terms of developing people and getting people engaged. They evolve around individual performance, right? How was your performance over the last few months? How can we make your performance better going forwards? Do you think you have good career opportunities? Not career in the sense of just upwards promotion, but career in the sense of interesting work and developing your own skills. And are we doing the right things to make sure that you stay engaged? And around each of these, you can provide good tools and structures for the conversation if people really want them or if people need some encouragement. But generally, a free-flowing conversation between a manager and an employee around these topics will be very productive. And there's some good BlessingWhite articles on the BlessingWhite website, BlessingWhite.com website, if you want these, that flesh out these three conversations and some of the tools around them. So that was guiding principle number three, putting the employee in the driving seat. So guiding principle number four is what I refer to as speeding up the feedback loop. This is a pretty straightforward or pretty simple concept. If you were doing performance reviews once a year, you were going to set the goals, let's say on January the 1st, and then maybe towards the end of December or early January of the next year, you sit back down and some things will be recognized, right? So the manager at that point will have identified some good contributions and those will get recognized. So, sorry for my doodling there, that was a bit poor. But there's also some things that weren't achieved. And in this case, the employee may be excused for not delivering them or may actually be penalized in terms of their bonus or generally in terms of their other promotability. But in truth, what really happens is that there are other important items that come up during that one-year cycle. And in this case, they can land in one of two camps, right? Either the manager recognized that contribution, that will really happen at the manager's discretion. But what's also quite likely is that it's not going to make its way into the formal record, making the employee feel a bit dismissed in terms of having done this great contribution. It was very important, but it never really got recorded. But for me, what's probably more important is this item down here. As organizations try to stay nimble and try to adjust strategy constantly, it's important that we keep people focused on the tasks that matter the most. And what I see happening quite a lot is that when strategic initiatives do fall apart, they're often swept under the carpet. And you're able to do that because it wasn't part of the formal record at the beginning of the year when you were setting the goals. And therefore, when strategic initiatives go by the wayside, I think it's very important that we're able to capture those by shortening the feedback loop and making sure that these do actually get tracked and recorded, potentially. And again, another great quote that came in during the sign-up. So we heard that in many of the comments that were made right at the beginning of the session. And then the fifth and final guiding principle that we flesh out in a lot more detail in the research report itself is this idea of the growth mindset. So in a nutshell, when we talk about growth mindset, what we mean is that we find some managers adopt what's called a fixed mindset. They assume that the people on their team are operating at a certain level of contribution, that if they were able to contribute higher, they would already, that they're about as smart as they were the day they arrived. And operating with this mindset means that there's very little likelihood that the manager is going to invest a lot in the development of people. So we try and encourage managers to come to the table with a growth mindset, meaning that they see a lot more latent potential on the people that are reporting to them, and that if they do invest time and effort into developing those individuals, they can get the performance of the team to a much higher level. So just to illustrate this a little bit, yes, and again, another great quote that came in, right? How do we engage the mindsets of the people to value these conversations? And that really is the crux of the issue. If the managers don't value the time spent on these conversations, it's very, very unlikely you're going to make much progress. Now, if you're interested in this concept of the growth mindset, a great example is the Pygmalion effect. And this stems back to some scientific research that was done, and I'll probably not do it justice by summarizing it very quickly. But in a lab environment, the head of the lab labeled all of the cages of the rats that they were using in intelligence tests. So the rats were running through a maze, getting from A to B. And the cages were labeled to say, this rat is aggressive, this rat is very smart, this rat is inquisitive, this rat is lazy. And what this scientist discovered, to his great surprise, was that the rats that had been labeled as smart or inquisitive outperformed the lazy or stupid rats significantly. And the reason that this was surprising is that, of course, he'd labeled these cages totally randomly, and he had no idea which rat was which. So something was introduced into the experiment, some effect in the experiment, which actually had a direct result on the performance of the rats. Well, of course, it turns out that his lab techs, when they came in, they would see these signs on the cages, and if the rat was lazy or was labeled as less inquisitive, they were handling the rats in different ways, resulting in the rats being stressed, or the mice being stressed, as they were put into the test. And therefore, being scared and stressed, they just weren't performing quite as well or near as well as the ones that were labeled as smart and inquisitive. So in a nutshell, the takeaway here is that the expectations that we have, both conscious and unconscious, of other people's performance through all kinds of mechanisms translate themselves into the actual performance that we see. And I think the best story I have found for illustrating this is the story of Daniel Kish. And if any of you are big fans of NPR like I am, there's a great podcast on This American Life which tells the story of Daniel. But again, in a nutshell, Daniel was born blind. And unlike most blind kids, his mum was not supervising him in the same way that most blind kids were supervised. So Daniel was allowed to basically go out and do pretty much what any other kid was able to do as long as he could figure it out. So at a young age, Daniel is doing what any other kid would do. He's climbing trees, you know, he's running around the yard, he is even moving around near traffic, which freaks everybody out. But it turns out that Daniel has learned, he taught himself, despite not being able to see, taught himself how to navigate his environment. To the point that as he became older, and this blows people's mind, it certainly blew my mind, he taught himself to echolocate, meaning that he can navigate his environment by making a noise and by the sound bouncing off objects around him. He was able to develop essentially a sense of sight, which is as good as the peripheral vision of most sighted people. And as you can see from the photograph here, where he really made the headlines was when people heard that there was this blind kid who would ride his bike around town in traffic. And that really put him kind of at the forefront of this kind of movement where he said, if the expectations aren't set around you, if the bar isn't set that you cannot do these things, that it's too dangerous or that you don't have the capability, people will amaze you and do incredible things. And again, I think the story of Daniel Kish really should inspire all of us to look at the latent potentials that we have in people all around us and to trust them to do fantastic things and amaze us. So with those five principles fleshed out, I'm going to hand back to Kristen, who's going to walk us through some of the more key points of, well, how do we make this happen?
Thanks, Fraser. So what we have put together and what we've found is four phases are really the key to making this all happen. The first one is to define the purpose and philosophy. Spend a lot of time here. Really do your homework. Get input from as many people as possible, from every business, every business unit, every level, every function, et cetera. As many people as possible. Having a clearly defined vision and a lot of buy-in at this point is important. Even before you define what the vision is and what the changes will be, get the input. That will help inform the changes. The second phase is to agree on who owns what and who's accountable for what and who will be held accountable by whom. Defining this early will help guide the process and set the foundation. Get commitment from senior leadership. Again, I did not say buy-in or approval. I said commitment. Commitment implies action. Ensure that your senior leaders are ready and willing and able to do something to support this process. The third phase is educate, communicate, support, and sustain. So this is the phase that brings in the organization at large. They will need constant, clear, and consistent messaging and for you to anticipate what new skills they will need. If you're going to change something, anticipate what skills or beliefs or knowledge your employees and managers will need in order to succeed and then provide that as part of the package. And lastly, connect to other processes. So there should be some symbiosis between performance management and other related functions like compensation, promotion, session planning, onboarding, et cetera. These four phases sort of underpin some of the success stories that Fraser went through earlier, and some of the pioneering firms have been using some variation of this. So the first phase, getting lots of input. So we emphasize getting a lot of input early on because this was a very clear theme in the research and the interviews that we did. Talk to as many people as you can, conduct interviews, surveys, focus groups, use social media. At Microsoft, they got input from over 10,000 employees in order to determine what changes they were going to make. So please do not underestimate the number of stakeholders that you need in this process. So we talked earlier about communication. That's third part of the phase here. So often we try really hard when we're thinking of how to communicate something new, in this case a new performance management system, to come up with something either catchy or we communicate in this sort of official and professional way, something like the employee-manager success conversation, which realistically is a total turnoff to the audience who are the employee and the manager. So try to keep the end user in mind when you're thinking of what and how to communicate. that's sort of a litmus test that, we've kind of developed is when the manager and the employee actually get together, what's going to make sense? So for example, at Adobe, they simply call it check-ins, which is a very easy, simple, and common vernacular that employees and managers are already using. Calling it the employee-manager success conversation is only putting in a barrier that doesn't need to be there. At the Gap, they call their performance management system GPS, which metaphorically is similar to the system that gives us driving direction, and it happens to be their stock symbol. So that was kind of convenient for them. The next phase, this is a reiteration of something that Fraser talked about earlier, the importance of education and training. So if you're going to introduce any new performance management approach, you have to remember all the new skills and set of beliefs and information and knowledge that both managers and individuals need. If you're going to change something in the tactics, you really need to upskill everyone involved. So anticipate what they'll need to be successful and then provide that as part of the program. So how long does this take? So we're ballparking 6 to 12 months. Now, I want to be very clear here. 6 months is aggressive. It is very aggressive, but it can be done. JPL went from scoping in August to deployment in Q1 of the following year, so it can be done. But again, we believe that if you take a little bit longer, spend a lot of time up front getting input from all the stakeholders, getting commitment from senior leaders, determining who is going to be held accountable for what and by whom, train and educate employees, and then connect the performance management process to other related functions. We believe realistically you could do it in 6 months, and if you wanted to take a little bit longer, get a little bit more buy-in, we would recommend that, and within 12 months. So by the time the next end of year review conversation comes around, you could in theory have changed the process. So with that, I am mindful of time. I'm going to turn it over to Kayla to conduct a little question and answer. I know we had some questions come in through the chat box, so we're going to do our best to answer those at this time.
Great. Thanks, Kristen and Fraser. That was a great presentation, and as Kristen mentioned, we do only have a few minutes left. So just as a reminder, if you have a question for either of them, be sure to enter it into the Q&A module at this time. They covered a lot today, and there's still more information to discuss, so we encourage you to continue the conversation with them. Their contact info will be available at the end of the slide deck, and we will send everyone a link to the follow-up blog post where they will address key takeaways from today and any Q&A that we may not be able to get to. I'd also like to remind everybody that the recording and slides from today's session, along with a copy of the research report, will be sent to the email address that you provided within 48 hours. And so as you mentioned, we do have a few questions that came in. I'll go ahead with the first one. How does a manager deal with the employee who drives the conversation but has a wildly unrealistic view of their performance?
Yeah, I think as managers, we've all dealt with that situation where you're in the middle of a performance management conversation and there really isn't great alignment between what you think of that person's performance and what they do. So, you know, here's a few pointers. The first is that the traditional performance management process where the manager is taking the lead does put people in a very defensive mode. So we do find, as I was saying earlier, it's a bit like haggling with a used car salesperson, that people will go in and will try and oversell themselves. So putting the employee in the driver's seat and having them drive it sometimes can mitigate that or can temper, you know, people's attempt to kind of oversell themselves. Having said that, that's not going to completely take care of that problem for you. Sometimes you find, going back to that structure and the level of trust in the conversation, that if there's kind of low trust or even low skills from the manager, there are going to be big differences in perception or where people want to be ranked if you're still using ranking. And one tool that many organizations have used quite successfully is to move to 360 type reviews or to have 180 type reviews, meaning I am the manager, I'm not the only person giving you feedback. But there were other people on your team who work alongside you who are also giving you feedback. That can be a delicate dynamic in its own right, but we have found that organizations have been quite successful in deploying that And there are actually many technical platforms now that organizations are deploying which exactly take the role of the manager out and allow people to get feedback from many more entities, which of course gives you a much better picture and perspective.
Great, thanks Fraser. This next person, they agree with the comment that employee satisfaction is not only about bonuses, but their question is how this fits with Maslow's hierarchy of needs when employees are not able to meet their basic needs with their salary.
Yeah, it's a really interesting question. I love it. Thank you. Certainly, everyone's somewhat familiar with Maslow's hierarchy of needs, and I think that there's an interesting correlation or something to be thinking about there. But I think the purpose of the X model is less to focus on what an employee needs and more to illustrate the fact that what every employee needs is different. And so we've all seen the employee who makes very little money but is extremely satisfied with what they're doing. And we've all seen the employee on the other side of that spectrum who's making boatloads of money and who's not quite so satisfied. And so I think the X model really is about illustrating the fact that we all have a different threshold of what we need to make in terms of salary and what other drivers we have. Some people are very, very motivated by money, some not so much. And so I think that the point of the X model is really to encourage managers to have those sorts of conversations. The reality is there will be certain employees who say, I need more money because I can't pay my bills, and that is a very real issue. But someone making that exact same salary might not have that gripe or that issue because they're motivated in different ways. And so I think the X model is really to illustrate the unique needs of every individual in the organization.
And there's a great YouTube video around the X model, so we'll be sure to include that in the follow-up email. The next question is, can you share some tips on how to shift manager and employee beliefs from management to participative and employee-driven? This person's concerned that their culture is so embedded in fear of stepping out that they'll need to make this change safe and forward-focused.
And certainly that issue of the lack of trust is going to be a bugbear if you're trying to change the culture. And these things tend to go hand in hand, right? So people's belief about the role of management, the way in which managers think of themselves in the organization, and building a culture of trust and collaboration, these things all move together. I'm not going to tell you that it's going to be easy. As we all know, changing organizational culture typically starts at the top, typically takes a long time, and typically takes a lot of dedicated focus and effort. But having said that, the one thing I would bring you back to maybe is the two continuums which we shared in this presentation, right? Casting the manager as coach versus manager as boss. So it sounds like you're very much on the manager as boss side of the equation. You're not going to be able to jump culturally straight over to the other side. It's going to be an iterative process. And you can do that, or the performance management process is one of the tools in that toolkit. So by treating it iteratively, going back to that trust continuum about starting with a lot of structure, making sure those conversations are happening, you can progressively move over to the right-hand side and to casting the manager more as a coach. Now, one of the things that I would mention, and maybe I can jump back to the slide, but when I was talking about empowering the employee as part of the conversation, you remember I was talking about turning the conversation on its head. And it would have been this slide here. One of the interesting things that the pioneering companies have discovered is that they start measuring the success of this not by looking at the number of forms completed, not by looking at the detail of what was talked about, but rather they will survey employees and they will say, are you having the conversations? You don't have to tell us that what's being discussed. But we just want to know, is your manager having the right number of conversations with you? And are they productive? And are you getting what you want out of it? So if you think about that dynamic inside the organization, before you had the manager being the judge and jury, like rating the person on the team, now you've got the people on the team rating the manager and saying, hey, manager, are you meeting your side of the bargain and giving the people on your team what they need? And we find that that very quickly shifts the dynamic. I'm not going to suggest you jump straight in and do that because it's quite a jolt to the system, But I would suggest that you discuss that kind of idea with your HR organizational development team and hopefully with your executive team. And that might be a good starting point for the transformation of the culture. So that's just a few thoughts there off the top of my head.
Great. Well, thank you. And we are over time now, so we do have a few more questions that came in. I apologize that we did not get them on the live call, but Fraser and Kristen will be following up with a follow-up blog post where they'll be addressing everyone's questions today, and that will be emailed to everybody within 48 hours. And so we'll go ahead and start to wrap things up before you sign off. We did share one last poll. We appreciate you taking the time to give us your feedback from today's session. So thanks again to today's speakers, Fraser Marlow and Kristen Bakalar, and thanks again to everyone who attended for your time and attention. We hope that you'll join us again for our next session, to use e-learning or not to use e-learning, that is the question. And that will be with Sherry Weppel being held on July 8th. For DP Strategies, I'm Kayla Roth, and I wish everyone a great day.
Thanks a lot, everybody. Goodbye.